Good evening and welcome. I'm Kay Aho, and I'm president of the League of Women Voters of Bloomington. Girl Scouts from the Bloomington 9-Mile Service Unit, please present the flag and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Will everyone please rise for the presentation of our nation's colors? Girl Scouts, attention. Color Guard, advance. Color Guard, honor your flag. Color Guard, post the colors. Girl Scouts and community members, the flag of your country. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Color Guard dismissed. And we just like to introduce ourselves. I'm Claire Schlichting. I'm a student intern with the League of Women Voters Bloomington and a Girl Scout Ambassador Scout.
I'm Daria Colleen, and I'm a junior Girl Scout.
I'm Adrian Musta, and I am a junior Girl Scout.
Thank you so much to the Girl Scouts. That was outstanding. We're so happy to have you here. Welcome to our 2015 Legislative Candidate Forum. Please feel free to have a seat. Thank you. The League of Women Voters is sponsoring this candidate forum. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization. We encourage informed and active participation in the political process. We influence public policy through education and advocacy. We do not endorse or support any political parties or candidates. We'd love to have you sign up as League of Women Voters Bloomington members. We are open to everybody, including women and including men. Thank you to the City of Bloomington for this lovely Bloomington Civic Plaza and this council chambers. What a wonderful space. And thank you to Bloomington Cable Access TV for recording and broadcasting this event in its entirety from now until the November 3rd election. To all the candidates for running for elective offices of school board, city council, and mayor, and to all of you attending and those of you watching on cable TV. Our forum chairs tonight are Amanda Crombie and Shelley Bergman, both members of the League of Women Voters of Bloomington. And now I'd like to welcome Debbie McNeil from the Edina League of Women Voters, who is our forum moderator tonight. Thank you, Debbie.
Thank you very much, Kay. I'd like to welcome all of you and thank you for coming to tonight's candidate forum. The forum for Bloomington School Board, and then the second forum will be for City Council and Mayor. I'd like to emphasize that since the League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan organization that does not support candidates or positions or parties, that the views expressed in this forum will be those of the candidates and not those of the League of Women Voters Bloomington. And the fact that the League is sponsoring this forum does not imply support of any candidate. The purpose of tonight's forum is to give everyone an opportunity to hear the candidates discuss issues that are of interest and important to Bloomington residents. We will try to cover as many issues as possible in the time allowed. If you have questions that are not addressed tonight, please feel free to contact the candidates directly. All the candidates who filed for office were invited to this forum. Here are the rules and the format for tonight's forum. The speaking order was set before the forum and will rotate with each question. Each candidate will have 1 minute to make an opening statement. Each candidate will have 1 minute to respond to each question, and all the candidates will have a chance to respond to every question. Each candidate will have 2 minutes for a closing statement. I will ask all the questions which have been prepared in advance by the League of Women Voters Bloomington. A league volunteer, two league volunteers, in fact, up here in the front, will time the candidates' responses, and they will hold up signs to show the candidates how much time left they have to speak. And when the candidates' time is up, I will stop them if necessary. There are no campaign materials, signs, brochures, cards, buttons, or clothing with candidate information allowed in the Bloomington Civic Plaza. And no flash photography is allowed. The forum is being video recorded, as you heard. I'd ask that you hold your applause until the end of the forum. And I'd ask the candidates to please be sure to speak into the microphone so that your responses are heard by the audience and picked up by the video. Now I'll introduce to you the candidates for Bloomington School Board who are appearing tonight. Michael Polk, Paige Roman, Maureen Bartolotta, Dick Bergstrom, and Nellie Corman. We'll start off with opening statements, and since we'll rotate response order, I will call on the candidates, not necessarily in the order in which you see them. So first, we'll ask that Michael Polk present an opening statement for 1 minute.
Thank you, Bloomington Leader Women's Voters, for inviting me here tonight. And I would like to say thanks for doing the hard work you guys do in our community and the hard work you guys do for the schools. And you guys work hard. And for me this year, learning about you guys, I learned a lot. And I would like to be part of you guys one day. Thank you. But about me, things I like to do. I like to create relationships at schools. I work for Wayzata Public Schools. And I like working with teachers, the kids, the whole staff of the schools, to build relationships to help with the achievement gap. Because more and more you have someone to talk to, you will always keep those relationships throughout their school years. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, for an opening statement, we'll ask Paige Roman to speak.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Paige Roman, and I'm pleased to be here tonight to engage in conversation about what I and the other candidates can bring to the Bloomington School Board. I live near Washburn Elementary with my spouse and two kids who are ages 10 and 3. As a parent with young kids in the community and the district, I'm looking at the school district from both an immediate and a long-term perspective, which I think is important for the board. I've been passionate about public education for a long time. It shows in my education and my career. I have a bachelor's degree in elementary education and a master's degree in higher education and student affairs. And I work at the U in administration. In that role, I work with policy and compliance and initiatives and the board governance. I look forward to hearing about the issues that are on the minds of those of you gathered tonight and sharing my thoughts with you.
Thank you very much. Next, for an opening statement, we'll ask Maureen Bartolotta.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you to the League for hosting this event. My name is Maureen Bartolotta, and for the past 12 years, I've had the privilege of serving Bloomington on the school board. The board's work is challenging but rewarding, and that is why I'm seeking re-election. One of the rewards comes in knowing that our district is nationally renowned for our early childhood program. Likewise, our Elements and Dimensions Academy challenges our brightest learners beyond the typical curriculum. Our excellent teachers, well-trained staff, and the learning supports provided to our students are second to none. Our newest innovation, the Career and College Academy, serves high school students who may not see college in their immediate future, but offers them mentoring and training in considering other post-secondary experiences. Our district faces shrinking enrollment, and while there's an increase in students who live in poverty, it may face challenges of being an English language learner. I think we're making great progress, and I look forward to serving the city and its students for the next 4 years.
Thank you. Next, for an opening statement, we'll call on Dick Bergstrom.
Evening, folks. Thanks for coming. My name is Dick Bergstrom. My lovely wife and I have lived in Bloomington for 16 years. We live about four blocks over that way on Girard. We have two sons. We have a sophomore over at Kennedy and an eighth grader at Oak Grove Middle. I am running for re-election for one final term on the school board. I'm finishing my first term. And my emphasis is on teamwork. I think we can accomplish a great number of things working as a team. I know we're all individuals on the board, but together we can accomplish a number of things. So anyways, I appreciate you coming. I do want to remind you that there is a lot of room up front, so don't be afraid to move up front. Thank you.
Thank you. And for the next opening statement, we'll call on Nellie Corman.
Yes, thank you, League of Women Voters, for hosting this forum. I am Nellie Corman, and I have served on the board for the past 4 years. I have served as a treasurer, being the clerk of the board as well, chair of the legislative committee, and I also have served as a member of the legislative committee for the Association of Metropolitan School Districts. I am also an AP Spanish teacher at St. Louis Park High School. And for the past years, I have focused, as a board member, I have focused on student achievement, parent and community engagement, teacher and staff support, and economic stability for a school district. 4 years ago, I ran for the school board because of the passion that I have for education. And today, I'm running again because of the same passion. It stayed there. It remains there. I know that providing access to opportunities and excellence to our children is vital to the continuous development, improvement, and success of our society. Bloomington is a wonderful community with an excellent school district, and I would like to continue to serve my community by supporting our students and our families.
Thank you very much. Now we'll go to the questions that will be answered by each of the candidates for 1 minute each. Here's the first question. How would you describe an effective school board member? And I'd like to add that this is a question that came from middle school students in the Bloomington School District. Again, how would you describe an effective school board member? And to start, we'll call on Paige Roman.
Thank you. I believe an effective school board member is one who understands both the challenges that face the district as well as the role of a school board member. I think seeing the challenges and opportunities that are needing to be solved from a big picture. We have excellent staff who run the district, and they are our resource for what the district needs. We are the connection to the community, and the board's role is to bring those pieces together.
Thank you very much. The next person we'll ask to answer the question is Maureen Bartolotta.
Thank you. I believe an effective school board member is one that believes in teamwork and gets to understand the issue, perhaps by doing research or going out and talking to the people involved in the problem. The school board we work on policy issues, and we work on and we leave the administrative work to the administration, and that's a very important thing that we need to remember. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Dick Bergstrom.
Yes, so an effective school board member, someone who's a good listener, someone who's not afraid to ask a difficult question when you're out and about in the community, and someone who'll stand back and listen, someone who can learn, someone who is interested in teamwork. As I mentioned earlier, we can get a lot of things done working together as a team. And I could go on and on, but I'm afraid I'm losing my voice here tonight, so thanks.
Okay, thank you. And next, Nellie Corman.
Yes, I believe that an effective school board member is the school board member that deeply cares for the students in the district, that knows and understands the needs of the students and the families, as well as is able to work in collaboration with the administration and with the parents. The school board member that can include the community in the decision making of the district. Also the person that can advocate at the legislative level. And also the board member who is responsible and takes care of the residents too. You know, taxpayers, our money.
Thank you. Next, Michael Polk.
I want to make sure this is on. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, good. For me, I think it's more or less being affected in our communities and being able to listen to our teachers and our kids and families and that are willing to be able to keep our relationships strong with the kids, with the teachers, being able to work together in the school board with the other members, and to keep ourselves engaged in the community so that way people can come and talk to us without being worried and tell us their concerns. And as a member, we should be able to take their concerns back to the board and talk about it and try to figure out what is the problems that we can take care of. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is, how do you intend to balance the needs of taxpayers with those of school children? And to start, we'll ask Maureen Bartolotta.
Well, I believe that the taxpayers of Bloomington have always appreciated the fact that we have good, strong school system here. And they supported that recently, the past few referendums. We've been able to explain to the taxpayers that the children need our levy dollars and they need our technology dollars, and that they've supported us. So I believe that as a board, we have shown to the taxpayers the needs of the children.
Thank you. Next, Dick Bergstrom.
That was a good answer, Maureen.
Thank you.
Well, to balance the needs of the taxpayers, well, all of us sitting up here and all of you out there are taxpayers. We want to make sure that we're mindful of every penny that we spend and make sure that we're getting the best use out of the pennies, out of the dollars that we spend. Listening to what the classroom teachers have to say. You know, they're the ones that are out there that know what's going on in the classrooms. Getting input from staff. Reading. I can't name all the pieces of literature that I read. You want to make sure that you're well informed. I'm going to get the stop sign, so thank you.
Thank you. Next, Nellie Corman.
Well, I think we understand as board members what the needs of the children are, but it's also important that we understand what the needs of the community are. And by including them, you know, in the decisions that we're going to make, we are also balancing. And then working in collaboration with the administration to get the necessary information that we need to make those decisions. Those are sometimes tough decisions. And putting our money into effective practices and programs in the right place.
Thank you. Next, Michael Polk.
I would say 100% of the things these young ladies and gentlemen said is correct. But on my end, I would think when we have to make decisions about spending money, the taxpayers' money, we should always involve the community about it before we sit down and make a complete decision, because they are the ones spending their money, they are the ones giving money to our schools. So I think we all should, even though you voters in to make those decisions, we still should be able to talk to our parents and the teachers and everyone before we sit down and really make a decision. That way we are bringing them into some of the concerns and listen to their concerns.
Thank you. Next, Paige Roman.
I think that one of the key strategies to balancing those needs or those responsibilities is through communication. Whether it is through hearing from teachers, from administrators, from the staff in the school about what they are seeing that the schools need now. It may be the state of our facilities that need reinvestment. It may be the curriculum, maybe technology. So we hear that. We also need to hear from the community as to what their stresses are and what their desires are. And then as board members, we balance that. We figure out these are the resources we have. This is the compelling case we need to make to the community to be able to strengthen and grow the school. And ultimately, at the end of the day, the voters will tell us whether they agree with the case that we've made.
Thank you very much. Here's the third question for all the candidates. How will you inform and engage the residents, especially those who do not have students in the Bloomington schools, to support improvements for our district? Let me say it one more time. How will you inform and engage the residents, especially those who do not have students in the Bloomington schools, to support improvements of our district? To start, I'll call on Dick Bergstrom.
Sure, I'm still writing your question. That's okay. I think this, how will you inform the residents, falls neatly under community engagement. This particular venue tonight is one way to inform. getting out, speaking with people. School board, it's not a part-time job. You can't just do it when you feel like it. It's every day. It's all the time. It's going to the farmer's market. It's talking to folks at the shopping centers. It's talking to folks in church parking lots. It's engaging people in conversation, listening. It's all community. You know, there's 86,000 people that live in the city of Bloomington, and we need to do the best we can to talk to all of them.
Thank you very much. Next, Nellie Corman.
Yeah, I believe it is about communication. It's about communication. It's about reaching out to the community, providing opportunities so that members of the community can also participate, educating the community on what's happening in the school district and how we're doing things and what the needs of our students and our schools are, and listening, you know, listening to their feedback. And, just community engagement in general, it is very important information.
Thank you very much. Next, Michael Polk.
I would say continue to engage the community in the school district, even if the ones that doesn't have kids no longer in the district, because they still pay taxes. And we have to sit down with them and talk to them about certain things that we want to do in our community, because they're still part of the community, and listening to their concerns, and not to shut them out because they don't have kids in the district anymore, because, like I said, they still pay taxes. And I think by listening to them, because they already been through this system, that they have a lot of things to say about how we spend the money in the community and how they bring their friends or their kids back into the community, with their grandkids to go to our schools. So I think we have to continue to talk to them and listen to them. And like we say, when we see them out in the streets or at the mall or anything, we have to sit there and talk to them. And I got to stop now. So I'm sorry.
Thank you very much. Paige Roman next.
This is another example, again, where it comes back to communication. If the only time that residents of Bloomington who don't have children in our schools hear from us is when their property tax statement arrives or when they're asked to vote on a referendum, that's not engagement. And so how do we, as a school and a school board, help bring people along to understand that the school and the community are interwoven? When the child next door does well in school, has a safe and supportive school, and a school that's doing well, has the resources it needs, that makes their family, it's another piece of what makes their family more stable, which in turn makes the community healthy. That is an attractive place for new families to come, and it's a cycle. And so it may not be that the neighbor next door who doesn't have children in the school doesn't care. It's about how do we help them understand about the interwoven connectedness between the school board, the school district, and the community.
Thank you very much. Next, Maureen Bartolotta.
Thank you. I think that in my experience, we've found that the senior citizens and anyone without children, they are still very engaged in Bloomington. That's one of our good qualities, is that people stay involved with the school district. They know what's happening. We do send out our, I believe it's a quarterly newsletter from the school called School Pages that helps start conversations in our when we're out in the street or in the grocery store. We also have the Sun Current, where we put a lot of our information if people have questions. And we've also in the past held community meetings if it was a big topic, a hot topic, to get feedback and to give information. Thank you.
Thank you. Here's the next question. Describe the achievement gap in this district. What causes it and what can be done? To start, I'll ask Nellie Corman to address the question.
Could you repeat the question, please?
Sure. Describe the achievement gap in this district. What causes it and what can be done?
Well, one of the big things that cause the achievement gap, it's when the students start kindergarten and they're already behind. You know, we do have that kind of situation. And that is one cause to the achievement gap, not only in Bloomington, but in all other school districts. And did you have a second question to that? Sorry.
The second part is, what can be done?
What can be done? Continue to work. Continue to work with our legislators. Provide opportunities to our kids from when they're little, you know, 4 years old. That's when we need to start so that we can really address all the issues that come with the achievement gap.
Thank you very much. Next, Michael Polk.
The achievement gap, that's something I'm passionate about, and something that I would say that it does come from when kids in preschool, kindergarten, but as they get older, get to the middle class grades, that sometimes the system changes. So that put kids in a position where they do not see someone of their own race, and it doesn't always come from the home, and sometimes it comes from the, I'm gonna say it this way because this is how I feel, that a lot of minority people isn't getting hired in those positions that could help out with the achievement gap. By talking to teachers that we have in the system here, we love to work with other minority teachers, but doesn't get an opportunity to because they isn't being hired to help with the achievement gap, because that would bring the cultures together where everybody can understand each other. I gotta stop.
Thank you very much. Next, Paige Roman.
The achievement gap is a systemic problem. It's not unique to Bloomington or to the metro area of Minnesota. It can trace roots to all sorts of inequality in America and the ongoing problems that we are trying to work toward that. As far as, it's our students who come in with different opportunities before they even get to the school, whether it's access to early childhood education, access to childcare. When parents are struggling to pay the bills and they have to work maybe two jobs, the ability for them to be engaged with their child and the same kind of level as a parent who may either be able to stay at home or work a full-time job 8 to 5 is very different. And so our students come in with different opportunities. I think one of the things that's been done that's been helpful is all-day kindergarten. I think that's going to show some signs over time. Where else we can get there will depend on the availability of money to be able to do those things, whether it comes from the state or the district.
Thank you. Next, Maureen Bartolotta.
Thank you. The district here in Bloomington has always recognized the achievement gap, and we've worked very hard, especially with our early childhood and family center. We have classes from birth to age 5 for parents and children. We have our Early Learners Academy, which works with the 3 to 5 year olds to help them get ready for kindergarten. We also have the Initiative for Lasting Change, which helps out at Westwood and Washburn with their kinder prep classes. So to describe that, I think everybody knows what the achievement gap is, and we have actually seen improvements in the past year. So I think we're on the right track here in Bloomington.
Thank you. Dick Bergstrom.
Well, first of all, let me say that I believe that all our kids are smart. And so it's not that they don't have an ability to learn. Paige touched on it, and Mike, actually everyone has, since I'm going last. We get them when we get them, and we take them, public schools take them, regardless of what their background is or what their reading level is or what their cognitive abilities are. And we do the very best we can with them. We have excellent programs to help them along. But I really honestly believe that all of our kids are the best and brightest. And it's up to us to help them understand that, just to sort of coax that out of them.
Thank you. The next question is, what are your priorities for the district in the coming year? Why and how did you select these issues? I'll read it again. What are your priorities for the district in the coming year? Why and how did you select these issues? To start, I'll ask Michael Polk to speak to this.
What are my priorities for the upcoming year and more? Mine is to work on the achievement gap, to get some positive out of that without leaving any kids behind, and to engage myself more in the community. And another thing is to be able to work closely with the teachers and the principals and the parents and everyone that's in the education system. So that way, our city of Bloomington, our district of Bloomington, we become the first district in the state of Minnesota without us following other districts. I would like for us to be the number one district. And by us doing that, we have to communicate together and take a big step forward together and not look back in the past and continue to work hard and give our teachers the opportunity to do what they do in the classrooms and respect them. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Paige Roman.
I think the two priorities I would have would be, number one, to develop the relationships needed to be successful as a board member, both with other members of the board, with the district administration, teachers, community members, community leaders, and such. As far as board business, I think the first priority would be to understand and to really advocate for whatever the board's future financial vision is going to be that through continuing to right-size the budget, advocating and developing an operating referendum, because I think that is a foundational piece that sets the board up and the school up to be able to do the big things it would like to do and to achieve the things it would like to do. If the cloud of money is hanging overhead, that can skew the goals. And again, I think that's a priority that's been identified by the board, and I would agree with that.
Thank you. Next, Maureen Bartolotta.
Thank you. Yes, as a board, we did set some goals for ourselves, and they included a long-range financial plan. They do include an update to our master facilities plan. We have set up two new board committees. One is a policy committee, and one is a community engagement committee, because we felt those were important. And again, with the long-range plan to look at the referendum and right-sizing the budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Dick Bergstrom.
So I'm not going to let Maureen read my notes. She stole everything from me. So the board does have a long-range plan, long-range and for this upcoming year. We're currently working on right-sizing the budget, and I know that all of you out there in the audience tonight and those of you that are watching on television know this because you're tuned in and you're watching. We're doing a lot of substantive work, a lot of good work, a lot of hard work on just trying to make sure that we're maximizing the dollars that we're spending. We know that we have less and less money to spend. We want to make sure that we keep the excellent programming that we have and make sure that our community and our schools can flourish at the least possible expense.
Thank you. Next, Nellie Corman.
Yes, you know, there's so many things that have to do with programs and initiatives, but none of that is possible if we do not have enough funds. And so continue to talk about how we can get more money, you know? It comes down to money. Sustainable funding, you know? We can get money, but we're spending more than what we get. So it makes it really difficult to provide the kind of education that we want our children to have. Also working in collaboration with the city council to address the issue of declining enrollment and attract new families to the school district. And community engagement too.
Thank you very much. The next question is, what are the outputs that matter most to you? How will you be accountable for them as a school board member? Once again, what are the outputs that matter most to you? How will you be accountable for them as a school board member? We'll start with Paige Roman.
Tough question. I think the questions would be, our outputs for us would be our graduation rates, our responsible use of our funds, retention of our teachers. How will I be held responsible for those things? I think that's the board's role, is to hire a really good superintendent. I think we have a really good superintendent, and work with them to figure out what do they need to be able to execute that vision. Do we have things in place that support that? Are there things that are hindering that? Can we advocate for things that are outside of the district, whether it be with state or otherwise? It's a big tough question.
Thank you. Maureen Bartolotta.
Well, I agree that the graduation rate is a pretty good judge of how we're doing. I also see our new Bloomington Career and College Academy is going to be helpful for the students that are perhaps not on a college track, but would rather go into a field of technology or construction, something like that. That's going to help a lot, keep kids in school, I believe. And just the reading at grade level, all the way through. That's important, and that's a good judge of how we're doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Dick Bergstrom.
Yes, thanks. Great answers, by the way. Really tough question. So I happen to sit on the board of directors for Intermediate District 917. This year I went to, I want to say, 13 different graduations. They happen at all different times during the year. I went to one graduation where there were two students. They were nonverbal in wheelchairs. And the people in the audience, there were three board members, there were six staff, and no family. And that particular outcome is something that I wish I could have changed. I wish there could have been more family. I wish there could have been this many people watching those students come down in their wheelchairs to graduate. That's an outcome that I'm proud of, that I think all of us board members and certainly our community should be proud of. So, thank you.
Thank you. Nellie Corman.
Yes, it is important to me that our students are successful, that they graduate and that they go to college, and that they have the necessary skills that they need to survive in our world. I think it is important that we continue as a board to do research in the kind of practices that we put in place, that we review them, that we identify what is working, what is not working, and how we can always do better and improve. Well, I think it's at the end of the day when you go to bed and you think about all those things, it's when you realize you're accountable for that.
Thank you. Next, Michael Polk.
I'm about like everyone else. That is a sort of a hard question, but I did write some things down here, and I put to keep our kids here in Bloomington, because I hear a lot of our kids are leaving the district. So when our kids leaving the district, we're losing money. So I would think by trying to figure out and ask why our kids are leaving us, and to continue with the giving the opportunity to people in our community that are trying to learn how to read and write, and to help our city grow, like the school over at Southwest there off 80-something in Penn, that ABD school over there. I think that's a good school for our community, because that way we got a program over there where our parents is going to learn how to read and write, and they can engage themselves back into the community and understand what their kids are going through. Thank you.
Thank you. Here's the last question before closing statements. It is the school district on the right track or in need of a change in direction? Please explain. Once more. Is the school district on the right track or in need of a change in direction? Please explain. We'll start with Maureen Bartolotta.
Well, I've been on the school board for 12 years, so I think we're on the right track. We're innovating while we're saving money. This Career and College Academy is a new venture for us, yet we were able to secure enough grants and funding so that none of the money for the first 2 years of this project are going to come out of our general funds. We've got partners, the United Way, Walzer Foundation. These people are helping us, and people in the district went out and found these people to partner with. And so I think that we're on the right track. There's so little money out there, but somehow our district seems to be able to find it. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Dick Bergstrom.
Well, I'd love to be able to answer it by just saying yes, but I have a minute. So yes, I think we're on the right track. I think we're doing wonderful things. We're not perfect. Can we get better? Sure. That's what we come to work for every day. You know, we have a very robust pre-K program all the way up through our adult literacy and everything in between. And I'm proud to be on the board. I'm proud to have served for the last 3 years, 8 months, and 9 months and 1 day. So yes, we're doing very well. I think we are. And I really appreciate your support, and I really appreciate your interest. So thanks a lot.
Next, thank you. Next, Nellie Corman.
Yes, Bloomington schools have managed to stay in a very stable financial situation until now. We do have a community that has a very strong school district. The district provides high quality education to all students. We offer academic excellence in all of our schools. We make strong emphasis in early childhood education. We offer accelerating learning opportunities in the schools. We use technology. We also have Artful Learning School and a STEM school. We have so many good things. We have programs for all students, all ages. Of course, there's always need for improvement, as there are in other school districts as well. But I believe we have a very strong and excellent school district.
Thank you. Next, Michael Polk.
Yes, I think since this is my first time running, and I'm learning a lot about the community and the school district here, that I think, yes, it does need a little change. Because if you talk to the people in the community and their perspective of the school district and things that's going on, they're looking for change. And like I said before, we need to start listening to the parents and their kids in our community, where things are going good, but there always can be improvement. And that's something that I said before, because it's going good, that doesn't mean it doesn't need to be put in a higher standard, because we don't want to continue with the same standard. Yeah, there's a lot of good things going on, but I would prefer to see us move forward, and I think we can do that. Thank you.
Thank you. And next, Paige Roman.
I do think the school district is on a good path and is heading in the right direction. As everyone said, there's always room for improvement, and we do that by understanding the needs of our community and the families, the students that are part of our district. You know, what are the challenges that our faculty, our teachers are seeing new students coming in, whether they're coming in kindergarten or pre-K, or whether they're transferring in mid-year from one district to the next. I think the board tries to understand that and continues to. We'll always have it. That'll be one of the challenges of the board, to continue to stay on top of that. And then in turn, you know, to continue, we've enjoyed great community support for the school in terms of referenda in the past. And again, how do we make the case to keep it strong, to help people understand why the path we're on is a good one?
Thank you very much. Now we'll have closing statements for 2 minutes each. And to start, I call on Nellie Corman.
Go first. Thank you. Well, thank you again to the League of Women Voters for hosting this forum. Bloomington is a great community with an excellent school district with proven leadership in education. Bloomington Public Schools, like all other school districts, will continue to face many challenges, which can only overcome by working together as a whole community. We all have the responsibility to participate in the education of our children and to ensure that our community continues to thrive in a supportive, safe, and healthy environment. If I am elected to serve a second term on the Bloomington School Board, I pledge to continue to work hard for the well-being and success of our Bloomington schools and students, and to work on behalf of parents, the school community, and the Bloomington taxpayers. I will also continue to advocate for the safety and the education of the ones who matter the most, our children. I am passionate about learning, achievement, and education, and I will continue to work hard for our Bloomington community in an ethic and responsible manner as I carefully make decisions that will affect the well-being and stability of the children and the residents of Bloomington. I hope to earn your vote on November 3rd. Remember, it's Nellie Corman. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Dick Bergstrom.
Oh, you're going this direction. All right, well, first of all, let me say once again, thanks to the league for hosting this. Thanks for making this possible. Thank you for all those that are in attendance tonight for coming out. As I mentioned earlier, I'm running for one last term. I've been on for almost one term. Two would be enough for me. So those of you that are thinking about running for this, you know that if I'm not successful now, then I'm done. If I'm successful, you can come get my seat in 4 years. My wife and I love Bloomington. Our sons are having a great time in their schools, Kennedy and Oak Grove Middle. And we have a vibrant, active community, 86,000 people strong, fourth largest city in the state of Minnesota, a fantastic mayor who happens to be sitting in the audience tonight. There's a lot going for Bloomington. And I would love to be continue to be a part of the board of directors for Bloomington Public Schools. So thanks again for coming out, and I guess I don't need any more time. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Maureen Bartolotta.
Thank you. I too would like to thank the League of Women Voters for offering us candidates this opportunity to come before the citizens of Bloomington to have good dialogue about the current issues in educational policy and the future success of Bloomington schools. I've worked for the last 12 years to make sure that any student in Bloomington, no matter where he or she was born or what part of the city that they live in, have access to the same quality instruction and vast opportunities that my own children had. This is a task easier said than done, especially in the face of the mounting fiscal challenges that districts all across Minnesota have had to experience. But we, as Bloomington schools, have continued to find success and innovation amid those challenges. If reelected to the school board, I will work to continue this tradition of excellence for the next generation. Thank you.
Thank you. And next, Paige Roman.
I'll join the chorus and thank everyone for attending tonight or who are watching online. Thanks for taking the time to be engaged and informed. That's something we need a lot more of in the community. And thanks to the League of Women Voters for hosting the event, for some really good and some really tough questions, and as well as for all of your efforts to get out the vote. I hope that what you've heard and some of my responses might have helped persuade you that I am someone who can add real value to the Bloomington School Board. I believe my combination of skills and experiences can make a difference for our children and community. We are a large, diverse community in Bloomington, and it's important that our school board reflect that to whatever degree it can. The board will continue to face tough challenges on the budget and student achievement in the next year and beyond. Its decisions, however large or small, do have real impact, not just on students, but on families, on teachers and staff, on our community, residents, and businesses. My promise to you is that I'm committed to decision-making that is inclusive to the extent it can be, considers all perspectives, seeks to keep people informed, and sets the school district on the right footing for the long haul. In addition, I'm committed to being a contributing team member, working with other board members to get the district's work done. I hope that I can earn your trust and one of your votes for a seat on the board on November 3rd. Thanks.
Thank you. And next, Michael Polk.
I want to thank the Bloomington League of Women for inviting me here tonight. And I would like to thank all the people out in the audience here and at home on watching on TV and online. I would like to have your vote come November. And the thing about me is trust. And if you trust me, I'll trust you. And I am a person that will always communicate with everyone. I listen a lot because the only way you can learn is to listen, to know what the community wants. I love to be that person to carry their concerns to the board. I would love to work with the people on the board because there's some great people that I have met these last 3 months. and a lot of people in the community that I have met that is great, that have thanked me for the things I'm doing. And my goal is to continue to reach out to the teachers and the students, because I respect all teachers and parents and kids, because they are the ones that are going to be our future, that will be doing this, what I'm doing now, trying to continue the job that we're doing. Because like I said earlier, I like the district of Bloomington to be the number one school district in the state of Minnesota, because I don't think we should be following folks. They should be following us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This concludes the candidates' remarks in tonight's forum. Thank you to the candidates for participating in the forum and for your willingness to participate in the democratic process by running for office. Thank you to the League of Women Voters Bloomington for sponsoring the forum. This forum has been video recorded, as you know, and it will be available for viewing online on the LWV Bloomington website, on the City of Bloomington website, and on YouTube. And it will also be rebroadcast frequently on Bloomington Cable TV through Election Day. Thank you to the audience for attending tonight's forum. Please remember to vote on Election Day, November 3rd. Thank you all for attending tonight.
Thank you, guys.